time for the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network. Tonight's show is brought to you by John Emerald Distilling, Southern States Bank, BioLife Plasma, Midas Total Car Care, Vector Ply, and PMB Broadcasting. Now to catch you up on all things River Dragons hockey, let's start tonight's show with Zach DeBozart.
Thank you very much, Brian Thomas, and welcome into the studios here at PMB Broadcasting, a Commissioner's Cup Final preview edition of the Coach's Show tonight. Jerome Bichard in studio with us here as always. Jerome, how are we doing?
Zachariah.
Hey.
Correct?
Yep, you got it.
Nice.
There we go. We've also got not one, but two special player guests today. We've got number 5, Kirk Underwood, and number 24, Brad Nolan. Boys, how are we doing today?
Good. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, happy to be here, Zach.
It's going
to
be a lot of fun talking it up with two of the first year Dragons. Guys have been here for a while, though. Feel like you're been here the whole year, but getting ready for the finals. Obviously, I know for you, Brad, you've been there before, especially in this league with the Carolina Thunderbirds. And Kirk, you're in year number one. There's a whole lot to get to. There's a lot of excitement in there.
Oh, yeah. Hold down your excitement, boys. Holy smokes.
They're looking at each other.
I don't think you could have picked the two quietest guys on the freaking team.
I think, Brad might have dragged Kirk into this to try and give him some backup. So
there may have been some incentive to bring Kirk along.
Well, we'll get to it. We'll have some fun. We'll get through this next hour. Talking about the River Dragons and their quest for back-to-back league championships, which starts up on Friday. River Dragons will take on the Watertown Wolves. It's 2 games out of 3 set Friday night at the Columbus Civic Center, 7:30 puck drop. Tickets are available Civic Center box office or on Ticketmaster. We know there's been some snafus with dates. We're working through that with Ticketmaster as best we can. But you can purchase those tickets right now at Ticketmaster, and they'll transfer over to the proper date. And then Sunday and Monday up in Watertown. That makes this our second to last show here, Jerome.
Yeah, you know what? It's been an eventful year. I think I've only missed 2 shows.
Yeah. We've had some pretty good attendance this year.
Yeah, pretty good attendance. So pretty good. Unfortunately, I think I missed those 2. One for my birthday, which I deserved it. And the other one, I think it was showing a house, and I don't think that one came through. So
what was interesting is one of the ones you missed was a Watertown recap game. That was when we were in Watertown, and obviously we prefer to forget that. But
oh, yeah, that was at Yeesh. Yeah. That's a long time ago.
It is a long time ago. And obviously,
9-1?
Yeah,
did we score a goal?
No, it was 9-rip.
Yeah.
So it was a tough one.
It happens.
It does. But now you think about it, that team from November into this team now, obviously much better, much different team. It's going to be a competitive series.
Yeah, no, totally different. Totally different team from when we were up there in November. And with these two guys that are sitting right here made some huge impact. And then really the last time we played them down here, I mean, that was pretty much our team. We were just kind of talking about it really before we got on air. We played well, but we didn't play like we did the last weekend, and even the Port Huron series, or the 2 games in Port Huron when we needed it to finish in second.
Yeah, I was going to say, Kirk, you joined the team around late January, so you weren't there on that Watertown trip, but you have seen the Watertown Wolves so far. It was a 3-game set. It's very competitive. They're a strong team. I mean, what are you feeling about when this comes to the series?
Yeah, I think a lot of people build them up, and I think a lot of it is just the name. Everyone saw them in first for a long time this year, and, everyone says Watertown, and then people build up the nerves around it. But to be honest, after that last 3-game set, I'm pretty pumped for this weekend. I think we have a really, really good opportunity, and we're hitting it right at the right time. A lot of guys are buzzing, and a lot of guys are hitting it in stride.
Brad, we'll be talking with you about your situation, but you've played a ton of games, yet you missed the Watertown weekend
there.
And but you still played against them as well. I mean, let's get your initial thoughts on it.
Yeah, I mean, same thing that's been already said. That whiteout weekend, we're on like the beginning start of, our team had kind of fallen into the roster that we have now, and we were just, getting used to each other. Guys were in different spots, so we were trying to solidify lines back then, stuff like that. So, in my opinion, we were a different team this past weekend from back in March when we played them here.
Well, let's talk about that last weekend of play. The River Dragons taking on the Danbury Hattricks. Semifinal round, obviously getting the midweek bye, Jerome. Seemed to be pretty instrumental. Obviously, Danbury had a ton of games on their legs coming into that particular series, yet played us well. Friday night in Danbury, down 2-0 about halfway through it, and then what happened in the under 10 media timeout? Because all of a sudden, 5 goals in 5 minutes.
Well, I mean, you know, for the most part, I thought like the first period, 1-0, and then shortly after 2-0, first in, or in the second there, and we're just playing very, very tight. I think guys were scared to make a mistake, and we were playing so tight that we weren't really creating a whole lot. We were playing safe and all that stuff. We were executing, you know, our breakouts and getting out, making sure the puck was out and all that stuff, but we weren't really creating anything offensively. And Jay Krupp's power play goal kind of got us going, and that number one unit, I mean, did a little bit of practice on last week against kind of Danbury's kind of systems or whatever, and man, they were throwing it around, and Danbury really had no clue what to do, kind of thing, and they got him running around, and then Krupe, you know, quick little one timer and got us going, and I think, to be honest with you, I think the wheels fell off for him. You know, Wilson, I think, mishandles the puck behind the net. Bang, second goal, and then, you know, the best time to score a goal on a goalie is right after you scored this and that, and it's scientific that I don't know where I got it from, but
in a Jerome Bichard funded study,
I'm pretty sure it's scientific where, you know, your goalie's pupils dilate and get going, get excited when they allow a goal, and not that that had any case, but you could see Danbury's how their body reaction, how they held themselves after we scored those two quick ones, and then bang, 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 they were down and out, and they had nothing. And I could see them being gassed and not be able to create anything.
It was just crazy how the goals just kept coming faster and faster in this stretch. The Jay Krupe goal, you said, comes on the power play, 11:14 mark. Game goes on for a little bit, and then we get 2 minutes and 30-some seconds later. That's the Parker Moskal tally, and then floodgates just burst open. It's 47 seconds, 43 seconds, and then, well, 27 seconds.
The Moskal goal was right after power play. Like, and again, the number one, I say number one, I shouldn't say number one, but I guess call it what it is. They pretty much had the puck in their end for the whole 2 minutes, and they finally broke it out, threw it down, and they went for a change, and Moskal, Hunter, Persani came out and created that or whatever, and I think McBurney actually threw it up to...
Yeah, McBurney, like a 100-foot pass.
...to Persani, and quick break, and those guys, Danbury, were trying to get on a change, and they got caught on it, and, you know, Parker gets a nice feed over to Huntsy and then back to Parker, maybe? I can't even remember.
Either way, it was a great goal. That tied it up 2-2 at the time, and then 5-2, really, by the time you blinked...
Okay, you just gave me a slap shot. Either way, whatever. That was a slap shot.
That was on Friday.
Tell the old man to stop talking.
That was basically Friday, yeah. 1,000 miles ago. Even I have a tough time remembering it too. But before you blinked, it seems like the game was 5-2. And I mean, that doesn't happen in the playoffs, Jerome. Getting the goals back to back to back. I mean, that was lightning in a bottle, wasn't it?
Yeah. No. And really, nothing really was said other than, guys, just let's go play, let things happen, type thing or whatever. And the power play got us going, and everything was it. And then it got kind of hairy at the end a little bit. And, you know, in third period, we kind of fell back to playing tight again and kind of protecting that 3-goal lead. And I'm like, guys, good defense is a great offense, and just keep doing what we were doing before and be buzzing down there. And anyways, and then they got a couple breaks, and we did get some breaks too, not from referees and not from calls, but I mean, we got a couple good bounces, obviously Wilson screwing up behind the net and bang bang and all that stuff. So
Kirk, Brad, I mean, what was it like on that bench? Because you go from 2-0 down to 5-2 up in the span of 5 minutes. That has to be a huge shift, you know, confidence wise as a player, to be, all right, you're battling with a team that, you know, is playing a lot more games than you. You're wondering rest versus rust, and now, you know, you go right into it, and next media timeout, everything seems seemingly pretty good.
Yeah, I think it's all pretty palpable, right? Like, after the first couple of goals, it was, okay, the nerves are out, this is our first series in, we didn't play that first series because we had a bye. The nerves are out, we're settled in, and then the third goal, and you could kind of see their team, right? Like, head started to hang, everything like that, and the boys just kind of grabbed onto that and tried to roll, and we did.
You could feel the momentum on the bench. Is that first one was a sigh of relief, like, okay, we're back in this game. The second one was like, okay, tie game, you know, new game. And that third one, I think that was probably the backbreaker, is that once we got a third one, we had so much momentum that we just kept that going. I mean, we wore them down that first period. Yeah, we were playing safe, but you could tell that we were still playing hard, and I think that still contributed.
By the official book, the Krupp goal, then there was 4 shots put on Brian Wilson, and then the next 4 shots after those all went in. That's an unreal clip right there.
Yeah, if I was the other guy, I probably would have pulled him after the third goal.
Yeah.
You know, just try to change something up, or even I probably would have called a timeout after the second goal, be honest with you. Just settle things down and try to reset or whatever. That's neither here nor there.
Third period, you mentioned things got a little hairy. That was an Aaron Atwell goal from Johnny Ruiz. Just a little seeing eye shot along the ice, seemed to pop up off of a stick and go in. And
well,
pinballed its way.
Well, it bad bounce, but I want to go back to two plays before that. I think we had two terrible icings.
Yeah.
One grade. And not calling them out, just it is what it is. I mean, and we were so good up until that point. Like, guys, you got nothing. Throw it off the wall. Get the red line. Dump it in. Whatever type thing. And Grader has all the ice in the world, and he's looking for that pass, looking for somebody. I'm like, dude, there's nobody between you and the red line. Just take 2 steps and get over the red line. Dump it in. So he ices it. It comes back. And then then Moskal did the same thing right after that. And then that goal was off an icing as well, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I don't know who it was that iced it, but it wasn't the same scenario.
We got a change it was like 3 icings in a row. We got a change. The next group got an icing, and then it was right off that.
And remember, too, the icing that the goal was scored off of was off of a media timeout as well. So almost served as a timeout for Danbury to maybe draw something up, even though it really wasn't that complicated.
No, that wasn't a
lucky shot.
That wasn't a drawn up. It went off like 3 guys. It went off your skate, maybe?
Yeah, it went off
just the way they drew it up, absolutely.
No. How did you get kicked out? You got kicked out of the draw, or who was out there?
It was Storage was taking the draw.
Okay, yeah. Anyways, and really the stats of the game, really, Danbury kicked our butts on faceoffs. Like, I mean,
73-27 was the stat.
Yeah, no, and you know, it goes to show you, like, the faceoffs do matter. I mean,
I think Johnny Ruiz in that game took like some 40 draws and won 30 of them.
He's good at taking draws.
It was pretty crazy.
Well, we negated that on Sunday. I think it was a lot better as far as faceoffs. I think on Sunday we were close to 50%, or I think it was 43 or something like that.
Yeah, definitely did. Closing out Friday real quick, 5-4 from Steve Mealy, but then a couple empty netters. Kirk Underwood and Austin Doe both find the back of the net with no goalie.
We can talk about the melee goal real quick.
7-4, oh boy.
Are we gonna
call out?
What do we want to talk about, Steve Mealy?
No. I mean, that's a kind of a veteran kind of move type thing or whatever. He's a right-handed shot. from my vantage point, it looked like he was going to ring the puck, and he kind of came back and kind of shot back at the net or whatever. And I don't think Macker was going out for the rim, but it definitely handcuffed him, and obviously you want it back. And, you know, obviously after the game, Macker's apologizing and this and that and whatever. I'm like, that's why you never criticize anybody else. When they make a mistake and cause something, you never criticize anybody. As much as it is, as much as you know, everybody knows, I don't need to hear it from you, because you never know when it's going to be you. You never know when it's going to be you. So, you know, then you don't have to ask for forgiveness. It's just part of the game. And that, it is part of the game.
Look at that.
It happens in the NHL.
That's right. Yep. It does. Good life lessons from Jerome today. Wrapping up Friday, just putting a bow on it. Kirk Underwood got one of the empty net goals. First playoff point. Empty netter, sure, but has to feel good, right?
Yeah, it feels good. Honestly, I was trying to walk it all the way in, and right at the last second, it hit a bad patch of ice, and I almost missed. So I'm relieved that it went in.
That would have been the worst, because your goal made it 6-4. If that doesn't go in at 5-4 and they come back around, who is it? Dallas Stars, Edmonton Oilers, that number one pick? You remember that?
Yeah, way back when.
Oh, yeah. Hit that's Stephon, a, that, yeah. Stephon something, right?
Hit the post and came back down.
Oh,
like,
yeah, that was
same play.
Oh, yeah. So thank goodness that didn't happen. And then Austin Doe finishes it off with an assist from Jagger Williamson and Josh Pietrantonio. That's how the River Dragons won 7-4 up in Danbury. They headed back home on Sunday for game number 2. And we'll tell you all about that after this break. The John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show continues after this on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network.
The Chattahoochee's favorite place for spirits in the valley is John Emerald Distilling Company in Opelika. Conveniently located in beautiful downtown Opelika, they're open Monday through Saturday for tours, tasting, and bottle sales. Not in Opelika? No problem. From Birmingham to Columbus, there's plenty of places where John Emerald originals are sold. Check out some of their favorite recipes at johnemeralddistilling.com and give them a follow on social media at JED Spirits on Twitter and Instagram.
An injury can be a game changer. That's why Houston Sports Medicine Team provides urgent ortho care, Saturday morning injury clinics during hockey season, and an emergency room at Jack Houston Memorial Hospital. An injury can be a game changer, and immediate evaluation and care can be a game changer too. For more information, go to houston.com or call 706-324-6661.
Dressing for success is as easy as 1, 2, 3 with Wade Cleaners. Drop off your garment at any one of their 5 convenient branches or call their valet manager to pick them up. Go do something fun. Walk your dog, eat a hot fudge sundae, or go to a movie. Leave the dirty laundry to them. Pick up your professionally clean garments or have them delivered at no additional charge to your home or office. Yes, you too can dress for success with Wade Cleaners. Oh, and don't forget the little people as you move up in the world.
The final is set. The Columbus River Dragons take on the Watertown Wolves for the FPHL's Commissioner's Cup. A best-of-3 series that starts Friday at the Columbus Civic Center, 7:30 puck drop. Tickets available at the Civic Center box office or on Ticketmaster. It's the final home game of the postseason to get to the game and be loud in their quest for back-to-back league championships. That's Friday night at the Columbus Civic Center, River Dragons and Watertown Wolves in Game 1 of the Commissioner's Cup Final. Don't miss it.
Welcome back in, John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show on a Tuesday night. It's our second to last show because this is the Commissioner's Cup Final preview, and this time next week, the FPHL's going to have a new champion. It's either your Columbus River Dragons or the Watertown Wolves. Best 2 out of 3 series. It starts Friday in the Columbus Civic Center, 7:30 puck drop, then Sunday and Monday up in Watertown. Tickets available, Civic Center box office or on Ticketmaster.
I guess look back. Sorry, Zach. This is Zach the Bozart.
And this is Jerome Meshack.
There you go. Sorry.
It's bad that you know the rhythm like that.
Yeah. Well, just look back. Look back at all the games that we blew. Mm-hmm. Like, we should be in first place.
I mean, it was... The deficits is big for Watertown, but you're right. There's a handful of games. The percentage can flip, and that gap tightens real quick.
Like, that's what bothers me. If anything bothers me this year, it's the fact that, you know, yes, we do have a couple different players in there that have made impacts coming in, you being one of them. You've been here for the most part.
41-plus games.
Huh? But... you know, to add in a Moskal and or Storge and Joe Smith and Jack Riley, I mean, for the most part, you know, I guess it would be one line, three players that are different than, you know, past or whatever. The fact that we can hit a switch and play as well and play as consistent and confident and quick, as opposed to how we were playing when I come in and scream in between first and second periods, like, what are we doing? Like, you guys, can you answer that? Because that's what gets me, because we've blown a lot of games and leads and this and that. And I get it every, it happens every year, and I get it. Like, the playoffs, you do hit a switch and you get another level of... what's the word I'm looking for?
Consistency?
No, awareness, or just that hunger, just that extra, more awareness and more alertness, and you know what I mean?
Definitely. Yeah, it's, I don't know if it's just that there's more on the line now. Like, the games mean more.
But everything was on the line, because at the end of the day, we could be playing two here and, you know, type thing. And that's what drives me crazy.
Maybe regular season's kind of out of sight on mine. It feels so far away that, right. You know.
That's what I was going
to
say.
You're just trying to win weekends. You're just trying to win one game at a time, kind of. And, you know, you drop one. It's like, it's all right. You know, we still got plenty of games left.
A one-week series is a lot easier to encapsulate than, you know, 5-6 month regular season, because you think, there's still time. And there is no time anymore.
Right.
Yeah.
It's a good way to look at it.
I think a lot of it comes down to execution, too, right? Like, a lot of times these guys are going through and they're making plays, and it's not bearing down on every single puck, not trying to catch every single pass or make every single pass. I think a lot of games get lost in that, in the execution, and just taking maybe a pass or a shift off.
Well, and I'll take responsibility on that, and I don't know if I've changed over the last month or whatever. I don't think I have, but I mean, I don't know if I have. I don't know. More my tone. If anything, my tone is a little different. But
you've been hammering home the execution thing, and I think team is, you know, taking that to heart now and is really bought into that. That if we do execute what we do are planning going into each weekend, we can be successful. I think that was getting lost in the regular season.
Well, and it all kind of starts, like, my philosophy is the first part of the season is mine to get you guys to play the way I need you to play. The second part is yours. Like, I mean, and at the end of the day, it's not my team anymore right now. It's all of you, because at the end of the day, I can't play. I can't do anything. I can't execute. All I can do is keep you guys kind of on the same page. And I guess prior to that, maybe it's probably more, you know, I do have a big bark when I do bark, but I don't follow up with the bite by you're not playing and you're not playing and you're not playing. You know what I mean? And that's not how I coach to begin with, but, you know, at the end of the day, if you want to play my way, you'll be here. If you don't want to play my way, you won't be here, kind of thing. Anyways. Sorry, I don't know where we're going with that.
No, you're good. I was happy to let it roll for a bit. We just talked about Friday in the last segment. The 7-4 win over the Danbury Hattricks set Columbus up with a 1-0 series lead, and the series shifted back to the Columbus Civic Center for a Sunday game, 6 o'clock puck drop, and the River Dragons come away 5-1 winners. Coming off the bus, real long road trip to get back. How much did that extra, you know, like, just not even worrying about, hey, Saturday?
I didn't think it was that long, to be honest with you.
Really? So obviously the day helped out, though, because the River Dragons came out and did the job and ended up finishing off the series.
Yeah, no, I mean, we got on the bus as quick as as we could. I mean, I think the boys were a little ticked off that we were actually transporting Dan Berry's equipment with us.
Good karma, right?
You know, which to me, you know, help a partner out, great, whatever. But, you know, more so, to me, that's motivation. Why in the hell are we taking their equipment? Screw these guys type thing or whatever. Just give you something else to hate them for.
Well, it worked.
Hate them for and stick it to them a little bit. So.
Well, it worked. Two goals in the first two periods, one from MJ Graham, 11:31 mark of the first, another from Alex Storjahan, 6:47 in the second. And I kind of asked you a little bit off the air, Jerome, but it really seemed like from the first game when Danbury was up 2-0, outside of that 5 minutes, you felt like they were competitive. They were always in it. 40 minutes in, it's only 2-0. I mean, you didn't think Danbury could have kept that going for how long and how much you've been traveling, how many games have been going back and on, right?
Yeah, no, you know, they have some guys that could put the puck in the net and this and that, but I mean, I could feel it that they didn't have it. Good thing about Danbury, where the ice was pretty good. It's colder, even though it was nice out up there or whatever, but it was colder. The rink is colder. The ice was better. Come down south, it's 80 degrees out. Our beautiful Civic Center is as great as the building is. Our ice is like skating in cement and very heavy, which plays into our hands because those guys are up north and they're playing on good ice all the time.
And we're used to it.
And it's quicker, this and that. And it's tougher to play down here. The humidity in the air drains you and this and that. So we deal with it all the time. So it's definitely an advantage to us for that. But, we really didn't give them much of anything. They had a couple good looks. Bailey made probably a handful of really good saves on Sunday, but I mean, he didn't have a whole lot of work. I thought we played really well.
Brad, at the player level, you know, Jerome just talked about the different ice conditions and going from Danbury to Columbus. I mean, how much does your game have to shift? How much do you have to pay attention to different things in different rinks across this league?
The only thing we really have to pay attention to is our boards.
That's true.
Our boards, they must have put them in and out because we had a different kick on a different corner.
Yeah, we actually had to adapt to that. But again, it's we're used to that. I think we're actually better off going up there and get on good ice and having the team come down to us then next and then having to play on that ice because we are so used to that ice and it's worse shape. We could still play on it. And, you know, Sunday was decent. It wasn't – we've had it worse, but it was at that point where we could still play on it. We, you know, deal
with that. No, the ice wasn't terribly bad. Like, I mean, it was – we have – it has been worse here, but, I mean, it's still a little heavier and this and that. And then you got Danbury that's played – you know, six games and
six and seven. I think the season finished 8-11.
Yeah. So, I mean, sorry, guys.
Hey, it's how it falls sometimes. Kirk, from your perspective, being a Colorado native, you know, a lot of the places you played, especially as a youth, you're growing up in that thinner air. And now you come down here and you're playing in probably the heaviest air you've ever played in, right?
Yeah. It's different for sure. The biggest thing that I notice is how soft the ice is, right? And just skating, trying to take a full stride is a little bit different. So just like Jerome said, it's different, right? It slows the game down a little bit. And sometimes the ice is a little wet and a little bumpy, so you got to be ready for those bounces and kind of adjust accordingly. And we did. And we picked up on a lot of that kind of stuff.
We were ready. We were up 2-0 through 40, and then back-to-back goals, seemingly with a dagger. Jagger Williamson and MJ Graham about 42 seconds apart, 4-0. At that rate, just sort of skating it out. Did get an empty netter from Austin Doe, and then the unfortunate, party got spoiled a little bit. A goal about 12 seconds left from Adam Dowda. Still 5-1, handshake land at the end of it, and the River Dragons heading to the Commissioner's Cup Final.
Yeah, I got to give Brando a shout-out because he caught a lineup card change.
And Brando?
Yeah. Was it Brando or was it you?
I was...
Oh, I thought
Brando was the one texting it.
Sorry, I thought it was... Well, hey, see, you know, it's good to know. Well, and you know what? I mean, prior to the game, I looked at that lineup like four times to double check, and I didn't catch it. Maybe it was still on the bus listening to Lindsay talk. then maybe not pick it up, but I mean... and that's a heartbreaker as well because Jusso hadn't played in four games and he was fresh and he's the type of guy that creates energy out there for that team. And you know, when you sent that to me, which, or actually you sent it to Frege, I don't know if I had my phone on me or not. And you know, I look at him, and Jussieu is sitting right there at the end of the bench, looking at the glass. I'm like, kind of tap at him, like, yeah, you're done. Your night's done. And he's like, what are you talking about? I'm like, yeah, you might as well just go off or whatever. And he's saying some words to me or whatever that I can't say, but. And then I'm like, you need to talk to your coach. He's the one that screwed up or whatever. So
it's just, it was a weird situation. And how it transpired is kind of crazy, because, you know, we get the starting lineups, which you and the other coach will fill out. They photocopy them, they get them to us. So we're getting the actual thing everybody's looking at. And when I was talking with Josh Starr, the Danbury broadcaster, comparing notes and just talking about the game, he showed me the lineup. And all right, he had the depth chart and sees Jussieu in there. I'm like, oh, so he's back and seeing in there. But then we're handed it. I'm handed to it while we're on the air. So my brain's not 100% thinking back. And I look at it, comparing names from the previous lineup sheet. I don't see any new names except for DeSalvo and for Wilson, which we knew was going to happen because they've been riding him all playoffs, give him the day, and try and win the series in Columbus. So that's what I said. I said, hey, no changes to the lineup save for this, right? And then what, two shifts into the game, there's an orange 22 flying down there. And that's when I started to trip up, go, wait a minute. And then thankfully, Scott, color commentator next to me, Scott realizes it. I pointed out to him, and then if anybody noticed on the broadcast, Scott was quiet for about 5 or 6 minutes. So the like chain of it went from myself realizing to Scott to Jeff to Paul to Jerome, eventually to the referees. A crazy game of telephone that actually had its intended effect, I guess.
Yeah, no, it that kind of put them kind of a little bit on the heels as well. And when you do that to somebody, you better be on your toes, because that's kind of a motivator as yeah. type thing. And that was before we scored, I think, too.
It was.
Type thing.
So, 10 minute mark or so.
Yeah. But no, that really, I think that kind of whatever. I've caught a couple people do that. I've only made that mistake once in my 16 years coaching, I think.
You remember it though, don't you?
I do. I know exactly. Sam Bowles in Fayetteville, North Carolina.
Ooh.
Yeah, damn it.
It's worse when you're on the road, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. I think we still won, but okay. I think we still won, so it makes it a little bit better. But yeah, you know what? And it happens. Like, you just zone out for half a second. Yeah, there's 24, and you know, whatever.
The lesson that I learned from it that was like super risky was, I was in college, calling for my college team. Occasionally, the coach would give the starting lineup to like the captain and the players, let them fill it out, decide who wants to start, right? Which I was like, okay, this is college club hockey, you gotta love that. But at the end of it, he would then take it back and then make sure none of them screwed up the numbers. And that's what he told me. He was like, yeah, because if they screw up a number, that person can't play. And I'm like, oh. And it's one of those things you keep in the back of your head. You think,
It's not the number. It's right. The name. No matter what the number is.
It's still going to match up, though.
But. No, you can make a mistake with a number. Really? The name has to be on the number. Okay. Numbers are irrelevant. The name is there. Numbers, I don't think the numbers matter.
Well, either way, that's always stuck in my head. And I'm like, I don't know if I'll ever need to worry about that. But here we are. And I believe that's happened twice here in Columbus now.
Yeah.
This is some crazy stuff. River Dragons win 5-1 on Sunday, defeating the Danbury Hattricks. MJ Graham in a three-point night, 2 goals and an assist. Jagger Williamson keeps up his absurd streak. He had a goal in that one. His points per game has been through the roof, it seems like, the last 4 or 5. And then, as you mentioned, Bailey McBurney didn't have much to do. Stopped as many as he could. Then missed that one with about 12 seconds left. Danbury got one for the road. That was about it. And the River Dragons now heading on to Watertown.
I think that was a bad call, too, by the way. I mean, to put us down.
Oh, well.
I mean, you know, whatever. Nelly, it was a great hit on Melee, which that was probably Steve's fault. And then, whatchamacallit, Ojic, I mean, I don't think he dropped his gloves all year, or maybe he has, but I mean. Like,
goes guys, after Vanelli.
Guys, it's 5-0.
Yeah.
It's 5-0. Like, why are you even, like, just let's get the game over with. Like, come on. To me, win and lose. You win with class and you lose with class. The game's over. The series over. Just play it out. Let's go.
Well, either way, they found one in the back, 5-1, but River Dragons take on the Watertown Wolves now in a best-of-three series. We'll be talking more about that later on in the show. When we come back, we'll talk a little bit with our special player guests, Brad Nolan and Kirk Underwood, after this. John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show, Columbus River Dragons Radio Network.
At Southern States Bank, the Common Sense Bank, we're a true community bank that supports the places we serve. Our people live, work, and play in your community. And you will find us cheering for the River Dragons right alongside you in the stands. With convenient locations throughout Alabama and Georgia, we're never too far away to handle any of your financial concerns. Call, click, or come by and see how we can help you make sense out of your banking. Visit us online at southernstatesbank.net. Southern States Bank, member FDIC. Equal housing lender. NMLS number 410611.
It's time to get outdoors and tackle your to-do list. Whether you're mowing, gardening, or tackling heavier projects at the camper farm, be prepared with John Deere equipment from Sun South. We'll help you find the equipment to meet your needs. And owning a John Deere is more affordable than ever at Sun South with 0% financing on most models, including the 1023 tractor with loader for only $169 a month. So why wait another season to do more? Come see us at Sun South. Equipment for those that do.
Some restrictions apply. See dealer for details. Offer expires April 30th, 2022.
Let Shredaway, a division of the Overbee Company, take care of all your document shredding needs. We can design a custom shredding program for your business today. No need to purchase equipment, no maintenance expenses, no need to prepare records for destruction, increase employee productivity, increase security, no worry. Was it really destroyed? Right now, all new customers can receive 10% off. Shredaway, a division of the Overbee Company, locally owned and operated in downtown Columbus. That's Shredaway, 706-577-9668.
The final is set. The Columbus River Dragons take on the Watertown Wolves for the FPHL's Commissioner's Cup. A best-of-three series that starts Friday at the Columbus Civic Center, 7:30 puck drop. Tickets available at the Civic Center box office or on Ticketmaster. It's the final home game of the postseason to get to the game and be loud in their quest for back-to-back league championships. That's Friday night at the Columbus Civic Center. River Dragons and Watertown Wolves in Game 1 of the Commissioner's Cup Final. Don't miss it.
Welcome back in, John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show here on a Tuesday night, our second to last show as we're getting ready and previewing the Commissioner's Cup Final. Your Columbus River Dragons taking on the Watertown Wolves, a best 2 out of 3 set that will start on Friday at the Columbus Civic Center. John Emerald Distilling, proud partners of Ignite Sports and Entertainment. Live tours and tastings every day they're open in Opelika, Alabama. And hey, coming out this Friday, sample the John Emerald line of products yourself when doors open. It'll be open at 6:30 for our 7:30 puck drop. Tickets available, Civic Center box office or on Ticketmaster. Jerome Bichard in studio with us, as is not one but two special player guests, Brad Nolan and Kirk Underwood. Usually we take this time to interview one of you guys. Now there's two of you, and I just don't know where to start. I mean, do we go with the seniority and Brad? I mean, do we go with Kirk? I don't know. Who am I talking to
we
first?
We can just go back. Back and forth.
All right. Well, let's
try something different.
All right. Tell you what. Let's start it out because Brad, you were here earlier than Kirk was. You joined the River Dragons. Your previous team in North America was the Carolina Thunderbirds, right, winning the FPHL's Commissioner's Cup that year. But prior to your two FPHL stops, you were playing over in Europe with FC Barcelona, a name I think sports fans around the world will recognize. Maybe not so much for ice hockey, but you were there sporting the red and blue for FC Barcelona in Spain. Take us through that. I know it had something to do with schooling, right?
Yeah, that was kind of a crazy situation because after, you know, I went in Carolina, I had already been accepted to grad school. I never got to study abroad during undergrad because of hockey. You know, hockey kind of takes up so much of your time. And I'd never been to Europe, so someone had gotten my ear sometime my senior year. I was like, you should apply to grad school over there. Found this school in Barcelona that, you know, was exactly what I was looking for and, you know, got accepted. So I'm thinking, you know, I'm into grad school. I might as well go to Carolina and play some hockey. And that turned out great, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I think it might have been my dad or someone had mentioned, like, you know, they play, there's professional hockey over there. There's a team there. Like, what can you do to get in contact if you want to keep playing? I was like, I have no idea. So I just started just picking up names, found out the coach actually was a dual citizen, American, Spanish, and he actually played a little bit at UMass Boston Division III. So I was like, you know what, shot in the dark, might as well, you know, reach out to this guy and see what he thinks. And next thing you know, the, you know, he's telling me to bring my stuff and see how things go. And I, you know, I land on the team and go to school and had a great time while I was there.
The Division III angle workout, because Lebanon Valley College, obviously, so he knew, you know, the talent level you could bring because he had been in those ranks too.
Oh yeah, definitely, because yeah, he knows that level of hockey. I mean, he even asked me to put together just, you know, a couple clips from college, so I did, and he's just like, all right.
Who is the coach?
Marcus Fajardo. He's more of a roller hockey player. I think he's still playing pro roller in Spain. Great guy. So, you know, super nice, pretty good player. Ended up being a really good, you know, player's coach. Mm-hmm. He just really, you know, knew, you know, understood the game as a player, a lot like you, Boom.
Yeah.
And we just had a really solid team that year. And I think we ended up winning the regular season that year, but then the season got cut short because of COVID.
That's what I was going to ask you. Well, that's what I was going to ask you, because that season, yes, 2019-2020 season, yeah. And now, you know, you're an international. You were in Spain. You were there already, and then the whole world shuts down. I mean, that had to be a weird experience, right?
Yeah, because we were just getting gearing up for playoffs, and all that stuff was going in Italy. So we were like panicking, like, are we even gonna play? What are we gonna do? And on my side of it, I was like, am I gonna have to go home? And once they canceled the season and started, you know, all the classes I was taking were all online after that, and I was like, I should probably go home. So I ended up doing that, and it was about maybe a week or two later where everything shut down. You couldn't fly out of you know, Europe after that. So I kind of got lucky with that timing.
Definitely. Well, we'll put a pin right there and transition it over to Kirk, because in the 2019-2020 season, you were starting up your first season transferring from Chatham University, where you were a captain there, to UNLV in the college club ranks, and you were actually named captain in your 2020-2021 season, if it would have been played, because of that pesky little pandemic. But I mean, let's take it over from that particular point right there, going to UNLV. I know you're out closer to home in that area, being a Colorado native, and many people might not know it, but even though it's college club, UNLV, one of the premier college club programs out west, sometimes it's just what you have, right?
Yeah, honestly, I played with a lot of kids there that should not have been playing club hockey, to put it simply. A lot of kids that kind of fell through the cracks for one reason or another. Beautiful talent out there, and for one reason or another, UNLV just kind of fit their needs. But yeah, it was amazing. I had a wonderful time. Unfortunately, I didn't get that senior season, and junior year got cut short too.
I was going to ask, because the college nationals usually around March, and that's when everything was hitting the fan. So did you guys get to go to nationals, or did you like have that playoff postseason, or when was the point where it got cut off for you?
Yeah, no, so my junior year, our last two games were in Colorado, which is nice because I got to play them in front of my family. But we played our last two games, and then we had a week off, and then we would go to nationals the following week after that. Mm-hmm. And it got canceled during our off week.
Oof.
Just when everything kind of hit the height.
That's a tough break.
Yeah, it was.
Now, let me ask this, because the 2020-2021 season doesn't get played really at any college ranks, including yours. But on your elite prospects, they got you a C by it as well. So was there a buildup? Was there thought, hey, we're organizing a team? And obviously you were named captain. What was that like, thinking you were going to be playing and then ultimately, unfortunately, not for your senior season?
Yeah, it was just kind of like you said, there's a lot of buildup for it. We were planning on playing all the way up until like late January, almost into February. We were kind of hoping for an abbreviated season. And actually, Adam Vanelli played club hockey the same year I did. I think that was his senior year too.
I think Indiana Tech, right? Right,
yeah. And his school is one of the schools that got to have an abbreviated season. Mine was not, unfortunately. So yeah, there was a lot of buildup. We were supposed to have a season. We were working all the way up for like 5 months almost. Oof. To try to have a season, and then it got canceled.
Back to Brad. Now we're talking about you guys becoming River Dragons here, and Brad joined the team first through, when you're looking through the game logs here. Brad, you've actually been here 41 plus games now, and probably feels like that much and doesn't feel like that much at the same time, doesn't it? You know, you're rather spread out because, you know, you still got a place in Connecticut, so you love going up to Danbury, nice and easy for you. And obviously St. Louis, Dave, you're all over the place here. So talk us through becoming a River Dragon and becoming so involved this year.
Yeah, that's probably all contributed or attributed to Jay, which I'm sure we don't want to give Jay all the credit, but he calls me up. I can't remember if it was October or when it was, but he calls me up and he's like, you know, we need D. You know, there's a shortage of defensemen. And I had just gotten a job, and I was telling Jay, I was like, I don't know if I could swing this. He's like, and then he gives me, you know, the pitch, just get your 10 games for playoffs. And I was like, you know what, that's something I can make happen. I couldn't hang the skates up. I wanted to keep playing. So I was like, oh, okay, I'm in. Next thing you know, 10 games turns into 20 and 20 into 40, and here we are in playoffs.
I was about to say, 10 games was hit December 31st. So you're like, all right, 2022, I'll see you in the playoffs. No, you've played 31 plus the two playoff games after that, too.
Yeah, and it probably worked out because of all the games we were playing up near me, which made it easy for me to make those games. And it was just one of those things where we needed, or in my opinion, needed the 60. We had, you know, dealing with a couple injuries, you know, guys leaving and so on. So I couldn't stay away, honestly. I was really I fell in love with the locker room. You know, the team that we had right away was just was such a good place to be. So it was hard for me to not want to come back, you know.
Well, I mean, you've been steady back there on the blue line. We definitely appreciate what you've been doing. And it takes a lot to be able to do the travel you have to play as many games as you have. But it's obviously worked out. And we're looking forward to a pretty big series coming up here in Watertown. Then in January, after Brad had already gotten his 10-plus games and he was just showing off at that point, Kirk Underwood signs with the River Dragons in front of a two-game weekend with the Port Huron Prowlers. Huge wins for the Dragons, 9-1 and 9-5. Not only does he make his pro debut, scores goals in his first two pro games. Kirk, what was it like from you getting the call?
Yeah, it was awesome. I think I kind of set the wrong tone scoring back-to-back games like that. It was good. It got me here. I think I appreciated that. But
no, that's not what got you here.
For clarity, two goals and an assist in his first two games, full season total, 3 goals, 4 assists. You're a defensive forward guy.
I am. I'm a big D-zone guy. It was awesome. I loved joining the team, and kind of similar to Brad. Brad's actually kind of my connection that got me here. I was reaching out to him. I wanted to start playing at college. I thought I was done. I got the job that I went to school for, and then I just couldn't get away from it.
I thought it was MJ that got you here.
No, MJ wants to take credit for it.
You're going
to
hear that one every time. Anytime he can toss his hat in the ring, he will.
You can always link it back to MJ. It just takes a couple steps.
What's the connection there? Did you play with MJ?
We all did.
Yeah, both of them. So
the three of us all played together at one point in time, which you'll probably see on the Elite Prospects.
Almost 10 years ago now.
Yeah, I think 9 to the day now.
Small world.
That's the hockey world.
It really is. So, obviously, 2 goals, your first 2 games. I mean, you had to be buzzing. You're getting back into it. Hey, think you're over. Go into it. You're scoring goals. Things are good, and now you're established here with it. I mean, take us through in your mind, in your eyes, what it's been, because it's basically been a rookie year. I mean, I think, let me look at your stats here, 27, 28 games. I mean, it's half the amount we played, but it's still basically an entire rookie season for you.
Yeah, I've loved every single second of it. Kind of touching on what Brad said, the locker room has been amazing. Everyone just welcomed me in with open arms, and I've eaten it up. I mean, since I was young, all that I've wanted to do is hockey, and be a hockey player, be around hockey, and doing it again after I thought that I was done is unbelievable to me. I'm cherishing every single moment like it's my last, because you never really do know, and I hope that I can ride it out as long as I possibly can.
Absolutely. Jerome, anything for our two-player guests here?
Well, with Kirky, I mean, obviously he did come in with a bang. but, I mean, realistically, that's not exactly why. I mean, you just do so many good things that, you know, it's all the little things, and the little things win championships. And, you know, to me, the goal production is secondary, and that's a bonus. And you can score goals if you shoot the puck at the right time.
I've tried to tell him that too.
You know, well, and same thing with Jagger. I mean, Jags gets his five goals in one game. Well,
he picks up four assists in the first playoff game.
Well, he doesn't shoot the puck. I mean, he's got plenty of time to shoot the puck. And the Jags is probably one of the most unselfish players there is. And you're right there. You just can't skate like Jags.
Not many people can. He's an unbelievable player.
But, you know, regardless, I mean, from the first game, I'm like, yeah, this guy's legit. He knows the game. He knows, and at that point, nobody wanted to play defense on our team, and you know, whatever, and we needed that. And then with Brad, you know, he just reads the play. You know, small stature, skates well. Maybe a little risky sometimes at some point, but at the same time, that's more. And I say risky. It's probably more on along the lines of you reading the play so well that every now and then you misread or something doesn't happen that was supposed to happen, and that's happens a lot in this league. Oh, yeah. You know, type thing or whatever. So I mean, it is what it is. You take the good with the bad, and there's more good with both of these guys than there is bad. So
2013-14 season, by the way, for you, I know you were curious asking about this. The Philadelphia Revolution features MJ Graham, Brad Nolan, Kirk Underwood, and one-time River Dragon Preston Coogler.
Preston Coogler, that's right.
Wow.
Look at the talent from that squad now showing up here.
So you know Kooky Coogs?
Oh, yeah. We were around when Coogs really started getting going.
Yeah.
At the beginning of his hockey career.
It was the birth.
It was the birth of Preston.
That's crazy.
All right, let's take one more break. When we come back, we're going to conclude tonight's show with a look ahead to the Watertown Wolves. The Commissioner's Cup Final Series starts up on Friday on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network.
The Chattahoochee's favorite place for spirits in the valley is John Emerald Distilling Company in Opelika. Conveniently located in beautiful downtown Opelika, they're open Monday through Saturday for tours, tasting, and bottle sales. Not in Opelika? No problem. From Birmingham to Columbus, there's plenty of places where John Emerald originals are sold. Check out some of their favorite recipes at johnemeralddistilling.com and give them a follow on social media at JED Spirits on Twitter and Instagram.
Dressing for success is as easy as 1, 2, 3 with Wade Cleaners. Drop off your garment at any one of their 5 convenient branches or call their valet manager to pick them up. Go do something fun. Walk your dog, eat a hot fudge sundae, or go to a movie. Leave the dirty laundry to them. Pick up your professionally clean garments or have them delivered at no additional charge to your home or office. Yes, you too can dress for success with Wade Cleaners. Oh, and don't forget the little people as you move up in the world.
At Southern States Bank, the Common Sense Bank, we're a true community bank that supports the places we serve. Our people live, work, and play in your community, and you will find us cheering for the River Dragons right alongside you in the stands. With convenient locations throughout Alabama and Georgia, we're never too far away to handle any of your financial concerns. Call, click, or come by and see how we can help you make sense out of your banking. Visit us online at southernstatesbank.net. Southern States Bank. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender. NMLS number 410611.
It's the belief that your life should be easier, that life should be fun, and that the best is yet to come. With us, you have a provider who pours everything into bringing progress home. And it's not just some big name in a faraway glass tower. That provider is here. That provider is Beam. With local service and faster internet, the only place you're going is forward, and we're taking you there. Progress, your Beam, your way.
The final is set. The Columbus River Dragons take on the Watertown Wolves for the FPHL's Commissioner's Cup, a best-of-three series that starts Friday at the Columbus Civic Center, 7:30 puck drop. Tickets available at the Civic Center box office or on Ticketmaster. It's the final home game of the postseason to get to the game and be loud in their quest for back-to-back league championships. That's Friday night at the Columbus Civic Center, River Dragons and Watertown Wolves in Game 1 of the Commissioner's Cup Final. Don't miss it!
Let's go. Back here on the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show. It's a Tuesday night. Just got about 5 minutes or so left here in the show. I'm Zach DeBozart, Jerome Bichard, Kirk Underwood, and Brad Nolan on it. Having some fun with two-player guests on here. It's a fun format. We find out how guys know each other. Yeah. Philadelphia Revolution. Who would have known?
Yeah, good old Philly.
And you guys said playing against each other in college, too.
We did. Yeah, just 2 years before you transferred, right? Yeah, 2 years. So we got 2 years against each other. Only played each other, what, four times?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What was the series? What was the advantage?
Let's not talk about it.
I think so our team went 4-0, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So it was Lebanon's advantage.
We did get to play them for our outdoor game on the football field, which was a great time.
That was kind of like playing in the Civic Center sometimes. The ice never once froze.
Yeah, there was puddles out there.
Did you fight him? Did you try to stick him in the face?
Yeah. We had words, actually, in that game. We did, a few times.
Where's so that's Lebanon Valley's home game or Chatham's home game for
Lebanon Valley? Is it Hershey Park Arena?
Oh, wow, look at that.
So Hershey Park has a football field, and they do concerts and stuff there.
Is there footage we can dig up anywhere?
There probably is, yeah.
Oh, man, we got to find this, Jerome.
I scored that game, too. That was one of my favorite games.
I think seven people scored that.
That's probably true, too.
Oh, no. Sorry to bring it up, Kirk.
Yeah.
River Dragons get ready to take on the Watertown Wolves Friday night at the Columbus Civic Center. It's the final home game on Columbus Civic Center ice, game number one of the Commissioner's Cup Final Series against Watertown. 7:30 puck drop. 7 o'clock will be the Rally Point Harley Davidson pregame show. Get your tickets, Civic Center box office or on Ticketmaster. We're aware there's an issue on the Ticketmaster online reporting side. It says the game is today. That's a holdover from previous series. That game's being transferred, and all the tickets will be good for that Friday game if you can buy in there. You can also buy in at Civic Center box office as well. And then we load it on up. One last road trip for the year here, boys, up to the north. And at some point, by this time next week, somebody's going to have a trophy in their hands, either us or Watertown.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, I'd like to give ourselves a really good opportunity, and I think we do. I mean, again, we kind of talked about it. We match up really well with Watertown. You know, they got McDonald, Jemayoff, and Jimmy Lodge. That's their number one line. Their secondary and third are good. I mean, I'd like to think the key or the difference from now or on Friday will be Jagger Williamson. Jagger, I don't think when we played up in Watertown, Jagger had two screws in his leg and wasn't healthy, wasn't this and that. The little guy's pretty healthy, and then you throw in the way we've been playing, and really you look at the stat sheet, there's not one line that is making us win. All three are producing and scoring and contributing on the offensive side and the defensive side. And championship teams are put together where goal scorers tend not to be the guys that make you win. It's the secondary and the third guys, those guys that pick up the slack in the playoffs, and those guys score some big goals.
That's the one thing I was going to say too. I mean, the depth obviously is huge for the Dragons. If you follow us and you see the projected line reports, you know, for the playoffs and all that, and you look at the guys outside the top six, Underwood, Snorjahan, Smith, Krupp on that little chart, each one of them has scored a goal. It just shows the depth the River Dragons have right now.
Well, what I enjoy about it is actually this is what makes me proud of what's going on, is the fact that we've been through it all year. Not everyone as long as everyone else, but when these guys actually get what you're throwing out, and you know your coaching actually starts to be visible to everybody, and that's what makes me proud more than anything.
Last words to you guys. I mean, you heard what Jerome said. When you guys think the keys are, what's it going to take? Bring a Commissioner's Cup here to Columbus and go back to back in the league championships. Don't all jump at once.
Just like Boone's been saying, execution, execution, execution.
Yeah, I think it's going to be the little stuff. I think the little stuff is going to pay out huge, and I think we have every single guy in the locker room that's willing to do it right now. I think that's going to make the world a difference.
All right, it's going to be a lot of fun. All that's left to do is play the games, two or three, whichever one it'll be. We'll decide who wins the Commissioner's Cup for the 21-22 season. River Dragons and Watertown Wolves, they start up on Friday at the Columbus Civic Center, 7:30 puck drop there. Then the series will shift to Watertown Sunday, 7 o'clock puck drop. Monday, if necessary, is 6:30. All the games will be carried here live on the River Dragons Radio Network. We'll have YouTube on Friday. We are still trying to figure out what we can do, if anything, for Sunday and Monday. Fans will know we went up there. Watertown was a difficult building network-wise to navigate. We're doing our absolute best, and we'll keep you as up to date as we can on our social media, C_River Dragons, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, and YouTube. That'll do it for this edition of the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show. For Brad Nolan, Kirk Underwood, Jerome Bichard, and myself, I'm Zach DeBozart. We'll see you on Friday at the Columbus Civic Center, 7:30 puck drop, 7 o'clock Rally Point, Harley-Davidson pregame show. Have a good night, everybody. Let's go Dragons.
You've been listening to the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network. Tonight's show was brought to you by John Emerald Distilling, Southern States Bank, BioLife Plasma, Midas Total Car Care, Vector Ply, and PMB Broadcasting. All rights to this broadcast are reserved for the private use of our audience. Any reproduction, retransmission, or other distribution of the descriptions or accounts of the show may not take place without the express written consent of Ignite Sports and Entertainment and PMB Broadcasting. This has been a presentation of the Columbus River Dragons Hockey Club.